Well, today is kind of a special day in a lot of ways. It's the first day of summer, of course, which we talked about. It's also the anniversary of the birthday of Iceland's only Nobel Prize winner, Halldór Laxness, and I'm joined by our producer, Jan Murtomaa.
Hi there.
Welcome.
And gledelig sumar.
Gledelig sumar.
Happy summer day in this cold.
I know. You know, when you're looking out through the window, it looks really summery.
Oh, it
does.
And
then you step outside and you're...
And you probably
something can, falls off.
And you can hear it in my voice too. It's not summer.
A little bit of sarcasm.
Yeah.
But Laxness, Iceland's only Nobel laureate, he's pretty much a national treasure.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And we're going to listen to a piece here shortly that I made of reading from one of his books. I was reading Independent Sound, and I got caught in this scene where the main character in the book...
Independent people.
Independent people.
Yeah.
The main character in the book, Bjartur, he really wants to be independent. So he gets married to this young woman who has no experience of anything outside her village, really. And they move up to the highlands. And the first night she has to spend alone, Bjartur, he has to go off in the middle of the night in a huge storm to look for a sheep that ran away. And this reading here is her experience of that first night. And when I read it, I actually heard what I mixed together in this piece. And I knew it, I had to do it. And I had done it twice. I've done it in Icelandic and I've done it in English. And I'm pretty amazed by this text. And I hope I show the text of Halldór Laxness my appreciations of his fantastic skills.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. As I was saying to you, I don't know that much about Laxness. I've never really finished a Laxness book, but I'm going to. You're going to whet my appetite for it. Well, it's his birthday. Happy birthday, Halldór Laxness. He would have been 113.
That's a lot.
I mean, he lived to be 95.
Oh, yeah.
That's a pretty good run.
That's a lot from during that age to 95.
Well, this is in our appreciation of your life and work. And Jan Murtomaa, thanks for putting this together. Let's give a listen to this reading from Independence People, Halldór Laxness.
Shortly afterwards, it started raining. Very innocently at first, but the sky was packed tight with cloud, and gradually the drops grew bigger and heavier, until it was autumn's dismal rain that was falling, rain that suggested to fill the entire world with its leaden beat. Rain suggestive in its dreariness of everlasting waterfalls between the planets. Rain that thatched the heavens with drabness and brooded oppressively over the whole countryside. Like a disease. Strong in the power of its flat, unvarying monotony. Its smothering heaviness. Its cold, unrelenting cruelty. Smoothly, smoothly it fell, over the whole shire, over the fallen marsh grass, over the troubled lake, the iron-grey gravel flats, the somber mountain above the croft, smudging out every prospect. And the heavy, hopeless, interminable beat wormed its way into every crevice in the house, lay like a pad of cotton wool over the ears, and embraced everything, both near and far in its compass, like an unromantic story from life itself that has no rhythm and no crescendo, no climax, but which is nevertheless overwhelming in its scope, terrifying in its significance. And at the bottom of this unfathomed ocean of teeming rain sat the little house and its one neurotic woman. She had taken up her mending, but too listless to begin, sat motionless by the window, hypnotized by the pattering hiss of the rain. She gazed in a mindless lethargy at the grey darkness outside, or stared with childish eyes at the pools that formed on the windowsill as the water seeped through. But as the day wore on, a gale began to spring up, and the wind chased the rain in howling white squalls, beating them on as if they were so many flocks of sheep. These rain flocks rushed, spuming over the marshes, and taking on the form of waves about to break, they rose still farther, then either subsided or broke. Dusk came. The woman heated up some porridge and ate it, and by this time it was dark. But she could not bring herself to let the fire die out. The air was so raw, and there was water dripping from two of the rafters. And besides, there were no matches in the croft. And man's security lives in the light of a fire, and after that, in the ember that must be kept aglow. She sat by the range for a good while with the door half open so that she could see into the fire. Thinking to comfort herself with indulgence, she made some coffee from her mother's present. With it, she ate sugar. Also the gift of her mother, 5 lumps instead of the one, because it was her own sugar. Slowly she drank the coffee, cup after cup, staring steadfastly into the embers to keep off the fear of the night that waited its chance to creep over her flesh and shiver down her spine. She set herself deliberately to think pleasant things, and by calling up old memories managed at odd moments to feel almost comfortable. The sheep was silent at last. It had laid down. But the wind had grown wilder still. Gradually, the beat of the rain took on the rising note of a gale that pounded the window panes and shook the croft in its eddies. It was so late now that the woman scarcely dared move from the range. So charged with evil did she feel the darkness round her. She sat with her feet drawn up under her and her arms folded tightly across her breast, with the eerie feeling that someone might reach for them if she stretched them out. For comfort, she tried to keep her mind engrossed on her memories. She had been sitting like this for some time, and had even succeeded in forgetting her fears, when the sheep, tired of lying down, rose to her feet and with rested vigour gave vent to a louder bleat, shrill and cutting from the darkness below. It was as if it had taken sudden fright, as if someone had suddenly kicked it to its feet. For a while, as if pursued, it dashed in fright from corner to corner. Twice it stopped and beat the floor with its foot, blew into someone's face. Whose? Maybe no one. At last, she stole forward to the trap door and called down.
Little lamb, don't be afraid.
But her heart jumped when she heard her own voice in the emptiness of the dark croft. She did not know her own voice.
She knew no voice that was so fantastic. And there she stood, motionless by the trap door.
And in an instant, all her forebodings of the dark, an inevitable calamity that waited in the night, had become a frightful certainty. Down the length of her spine, there struck a paralyzing shudder, like a furious, excruciating pain. There was someone downstairs, someone who was attacking the sheep, seizing it evilly by the throat, someone, something, till it gave vent to another bleat, more terror-stricken, more despairing than ever before. No, she did not faint. She fumbled instinctively for more brushwood to add to the fire. The brushwood was her one hope, its blue, crackling flame, its glowing embers. The fire in the range must not die out. No, perhaps it was nothing, she said, sticking the twigs in with numb fingers. Someone. Something. Perhaps nothing. She was determined to calm herself by gazing into the little glow. The fire of her own home. The fire that burns for the idea of independence. The idea of freedom. No one walked after death. Column kill least of all. There was only the good god of freedom on the moors. The god who exalts man above the dog. Perhaps. No. She must not think about it. She must not think of anything evil. Only the good and the beautiful. Into the bleating of the ewe there had crept a note as of madness. A hoarse, almost expiring rattle. Rosa even began to wonder whether it really could be the sheep. It was a bleat, no longer. It was an agonized wail. Was the evil presence throttling the life out of it? The plunging and scrambling continued with occasional pauses. Something collided with the ladder and bumped into the door. The croft trembled in every timber. Then there was a respite and silence except for the squalls beating on the window and the pounding of her heart. She was hoping the turmoil was over, that the sheep would be quiet. But no sooner had the heaving of her breast subsided than a sudden blow buffeted the door, re-echoing throughout the house, and the attack had started again with a rushing and a trampling, a rumbling and a clatter, as if everything was falling down. At first, the woman thought the drumming and rumbling came from the mountain, or that the front of the house had caved in. Then there rang out a screaming bellow, and she knew that the sheep was being strangled. Shaking with terror, she clung to the bedpost and called upon God and Jesus, repeating the names unwillingly like someone praying on his deathbed. At long last, and with infinite caution, she started to undo her outer garments, slipping them off and standing in her underclothes. But these she did not dare to remove, for with every movement she risked calling up the furtive power of the darkness. Inch by inch, she slipped under the bedclothes and, drawing them above her head, felt some relief only when she gathered them so closely to her that no air could get inside. She lay like this for a long time, still quivering and still with a pain in her heart. No memories could comfort her any longer. Terror is stronger than the total sum of anyone's happiness.
She tried to think with hope of the far-off dawn, for human beings always seek some source of consolation. It is the search for consolation, even when every retreat is obviously cut off, that proves that one is still alive. The shrill cry startled her immediately from her coma. In her dozing ears, it took on an incredible note. The sheep had been killed. It had risen now after 3 hours by the aid of the devil. That hoarse, subterranean cry could not come from any animal born. It was the scream of the tortured souls spoken of in the scriptures. All the devils and ghouls of the moor had congregated to bellow in this one sheep. The spectres of those who cannot rest in the graves, of children left under a rock in the boulder waste to die, peasants with throats cut for the marrow in their bones, popish people who hate God and Jesus, whose one desire is to drag everyone else down into their own eternal hell. Such a fashion did this night drag on.